Tuesday, a very sad day at NFL Films and throughout the country. Actually, Monday. Sports Radio 94 at WIP. Monday, a very sad day for the National Football League and all of us as the founder of NFL Films, Ed Sabol, passes away at the age of 98. Talking with Bob Angelo, a senior producer from the NFL Films. My condolences, Bob. My heart goes out to you.
Well, it was a sad moment for all of us here, especially the folks who trace our history at NFL Films back to 230 North 13th Street, where I started back in 1975. Mr. Sabol was a larger-than-life presence. He hired me on June 6th, 1975 at 1:35 p.m. Not that I remember.
What an incredible man. I mean, the story of, you know, it was a raincoat salesman, right, who used to film his son Steve in the backyard playing football and took that, you know, that, you know, just that dream to Pete Rozelle's office and turned it into what we have today, which is unbelievable.
We all have our passions, and Mr. Sabol had his. He was an amateur photographer. He loved watching football. He loved watching his son play football. And coincidentally, at the time, a company called Telraw Productions had bid on and won the rights to do the 61 NFL championship game. Mr. Sabol doubled that bid, took it to Mr. Rozelle, and within 3 years had convinced the owners that the league should form a company to promote the sport. And what NFL Films has done since then, it's all part of the record. I mean, I've been part of it for 40 years now, and it's to see the growth, to see the size of the game today. The Super Bowl is a national holiday. It's an event. It's and a lot of this, of course, was going to happen anyway.
Right.
But NFL Films played a very significant role in that, and it was Mr. Sabol's vision that allowed Steve to step in here after the fact and turn this company into the monolith it is today.
And Steve was the perfect guy to take that role because he completely understood his father's vision.
Well, Steve only liked two things. He liked playing football, and he liked movies. And his dad realized that, and I don't think that Steve was the best student at Colorado College, but he certainly made a name for himself, you know, promoting himself with Sports Illustrated. And when his father said, "Would you like to join the company?" Well, that was a no-brainer. Of course, Steve had a great line about that, too. He said, "It's pretty easy to climb the ladder of life when your father owns the ladder."
And now, you started, Bob Angelo, a chief producer with NFL Films. You started back in 1975, you said. What was NFL Films like back then? Real family atmosphere. And talk about how that family stayed together and continued to grow throughout the years.
We were 40 people at 230 North 13th Street, which is now a Pennsylvania historic landmark. There was AstroTurf instead of carpeting on the floor. That's the first thing I remember when I walked in. Everybody knew everybody's first and last names. Everybody was part of something that was special even at the time, because NFL Films had been generating highlights for CBS television for years. Halftime highlights on ABC had already been on a few years. And, of course, highlight films and specials. Steve Sabol had a lot to do with most of those. We all kind of realized that this company could be much, much bigger. But back in the day, we appreciated what everybody was willing to put out. When I started, I would come to work. I didn't shoot Sundays yet. I would come to work on a Monday morning and generally fall asleep and sleep on one of the AstroTurf floors until Wednesday afternoon, when I finally would take the train home. In that time, we would produce our weekly shows. There was commitment there. We all had cots. We all had bedrolls. We would do whatever it took to get our shows on the air. And back then, of course, we were working with 16 negative film, as opposed to how we do things today. There was a lot of tape splicing and perspiration and, you know, just basically commitment. Commitment to, we have to get this on the air, and the only way to do this is if we're all willing to stay here and work late, work through the night. I did that quite a few times in my, first few seasons at NFL, and I look back at those times fondly.
And what was Ed like in those times? Because there was so much innovation going on. NFL Films, in a lot of ways, changed the way, well, definitely changed the way sports is shot, but it also changed the way a lot of movies are shot, starting off with slowing down the whole game in slow motion.
Mr. Sabol was huge on two things, film and slow motion. He insisted that all NFL Films cameras, including the top positions, shoot the game in slow motion. People don't recognize that with our images from yesteryear, but even the top cameramen shot at 32 frames, which is one-third slower than normal sound speed. Ground cameramen all shot at 48 frames, which is basically twice the speed that the game in which the game actually occurs. Everything was slow motion. We did have dedicated sound cameras, but not that many of them. Wirings were few and far between. So basically, it was on the basis of our cinematographers that NFL Films became well known, looking at the details of the game. That's where Steve came in. Steve always said that editing is nothing more than selected detail. And what we are able to look at an image that is moving through the projector slower, allows fans to appreciate what's really going on the football field. Steve was a big fan of extreme close-ups, being able to see inside helmets, being able to appreciate that these were grown men playing a little boy's game, but still playing it in a way that it looked good on film. Let's just put it that way. It looked good on 16-millimeter reversal film.
Oh, God, did it look good. You know, Steve looked inside the helmet, and Ed looked inside the hearts, as you all did, of everyone watching it. NFL Films growing up would reduce me and anyone else watching it to tears by the end of the show, whatever the show was about. You could take a simple play and turn it into an epic adventure that would just, you know, again, just tear your heart out. And did you know when you were, like, were you thinking that as you're shooting the footage, as you're putting it all together, this is going to get the jugular?
Every now and then, I will get one of those shots that I know will be seen a million times. I'm a cameraman now and have been for the last 38 years. Have shot every Super Bowl since the Steelers and Cowboys in Super Bowl X. And it's a great feeling. Wow, I've got it. I check to make sure I haven't run out of film. I make sure that I was properly exposed, and I just think, oh, I can't wait to see that tomorrow. But back before I started here, I saw that on television. Two things really made me want to work here. Number one, I knew a lot about football. Number two, growing up in high school, we would play slow-mo football. We would go out in the yard late fall and winter, and that was inspired largely by NFL Films footage.
Now, when you're doing that, as you're putting it together, are you hearing, like, how does John Facenda, and you know, John Facenda had already been there when you were there, I imagine, because he worked through the 60s as well. What was it like working for him, and were you hearing his voice as you're shooting your scenes? Like, are you thinking along those directions?
I would think of what John might say to cover this scene. I would think of the lines, knowing that John Facenda could read a shopping list and make it interesting. I mean, John's voice, and when I first met him, I was watching someone else record with him, and I looked in the booth, and I said, that little man has that booming voice. Such a gracious individual, such a knowing individual. I'm going to borrow a line here from Gil Brandt from the Dallas Cowboys. I interviewed him recently. He was talking about the computer guru who helped launch the Cowboys' legendary computer system. He said he didn't know if a football was pumped up or stuffed. Well, I don't think John knew either. Mm-hmm. You know, John was a local CBS affiliate newsman. He was the anchor person, I believe. I grew up in Pittsburgh, didn't know that, but I heard his voice on NFL Films, and I always, always associated John Facenda with NFL Films and vice versa. The two were inseparable to me. Working with him for the first time back in 1975 on a highlight film, my goodness, I could write the crappiest script, and he would just turn the words into magic. And after a while, we all learned how to write for John. Fewer words, the better. Polysyllabic names, try to avoid them. I mean, to this day, I don't think he said Ilya Nastasi properly. It comes out all sorts of ways. Ilya Nastasi. And so we all learned how to write for John, knowing that John could take simple ideas, simple lines, and make them grandiose, make them larger than life.
And who had the vision to bring Facenda in? Who had the vision to bring John in and choreograph that, you know, that movie in the end?
Everybody takes credit for that. I think it comes down to Bob Ryan, Steve Sabol, and Ed Sabol. Bob was the original producer hired here, a prep school buddy of Steve's. I think they all thought, we need a voice, and we need somebody local. We need somebody who's here. John Facenda. Wow. Does he know anything about football? Who cares? Listen to that voice. And the rest is history.
I heard you got letters addressed to God that would go to Facenda.
John was a remarkable man. He, in the early days, I'm sure if either Steve or Big Ed were here today, they would say part of our success, a large part of our early success, was due to John's voice.
It's amazing. You walk into Mount Laurel, you're greeted with 144 Emmys in the hallway that, you know, say hello. Did Ed ever, you know, just... did he ever envision that it would become as big as it became?
I don't think so. I think he knew he was on to something, but the popularity of professional football in this nation, which, by the way, Ed and Steve Sabol helped create. They helped promote. The popularity grew grew exponentially after the 1960s into the 70s. And by the end of the 60s, it was fairly clear that football was transplanting baseball as our national pastime, and now it's become a national obsession. And Mr. Sabol, I don't think anybody, even Pete Rozelle, quite understood how football would take this sport that at one time was considered kind of a, you know, something dirty that went on in and around college football back in the 30s and 40s, would take this sport and just romanticize it and make it what it is today, a national obsession, really. I mean, how many people watch the Super Bowl? 116 million people? And that's just in the United States alone, in North America. My goodness, that's a football game.
And one of the treats leading up to Super Bowl weekend is when they run every single NFL Films produced Super Bowl, you know, 30-minute special back to back to back. And you just get lost in the drama over and over and over. You find yourself shedding tears for teams you couldn't stand because of the way they would paint the picture. I'm talking with Bob Angelo, chief producer for NFL Films, on the day that Ed Sabol passes away at the age of 98. What was Ed like to hang around with? From what I saw, he was a fun-loving guy.
What I liked most about him was when he would invite members of the crew out to dinner, the very first thing he would say when we sat down, whether it was a local diner or Bookbinders, "Eat up, men, dinner's on me." He was big time. He was big time. He took care of his people. The day he hired me, he said, "Bobby," or he called me Angie, and this is before he even knew me, mm-hmm. "Nothing I like more than giving away money." And of course, as a 22-year-old out of graduate school with some bills to pay, driving a car that was 10 years old, bought used, I liked hearing that. He just made everybody feel comfortable. The workplace. I'm sitting here today in a pair of sweatpants with a short sleeve shirt. Ordinarily, I wear shorts and a dress tee or maybe a collared shirt to work. It was always like that, informal. Don't care what time you get here. Don't care what you look like, just so long as you do the job. And he would always say, FLAP, or flap, finish like a pro. Finish. At the end of your job, when you're worn out, when you're not quite sure you can come up with that last line of narration or make that proper music edit to make it finish on that climactic moment, or finish, finish, finish. Don't just play 3.5 quarters or 58 or 59 minutes and 40 seconds like the Seahawks did in Super Bowl 49.
At least he got to live to see the worst play call in NFL history. I can't wait to see what you do with that in the next special.
Oh, my goodness. I was standing right there next to Pete Carroll. I shoot a sound camera. I was shooting on the Seahawks sideline. And I've actually grown really close to the Seahawks over the last three seasons. Uh-huh. because initially when he named this young kid from Wisconsin his starting quarterback after trading for Matt Flynn, I believe the young man's name is from Green Bay, giving him $4 million of the computer mogul's money, mm-hmm. and the guy couldn't even make the start, couldn't even earn the starting spot. I felt sorry for people until I saw this kid play, and then I realized, oh my goodness, look what he's got here. But I was out there the week before generating one of the final shots in the NFL rally commercial, really, really grew close to the Seahawks, and I was just stunned. I didn't see the play. I was shooting the Seahawk sideline, expecting the greatest reaction that I've ever shot in 38 years. And all of a sudden, grown men were just holding their heads, jaws dropped open. I thought, what the heck just happened? I turned to my sound man, and he said, picked. And all I could think of was, it's second down. The best power back in football is standing right there.
What? Who just got 4 yards on a stunned Patriot defense from the catch.
And I'm thinking, oh, my goodness. How do you live with that? How do you live with that?
Well, when does the 60-minute movie on Malcolm Butler come out next year?
Well, that hasn't been assigned yet, but whoever does that has an ending. We've
Absolutely. Bob Angelo, how are you going to remember Ed Sabol?
As somebody who gave a young man from Penn State via through Northwestern a chance, I didn't have to start at, you know, riding Greyhound buses. I'm going to liken it to minor league baseball, which is something I always wanted to play professional baseball. I didn't have to start riding Greyhound buses. I jumped right to AAA, and soon I was in the majors. Just somebody who gave a young man who really didn't... who was just another one of 30 or 40 or 50 people who submitted applications and claimed they wanted to work here and could do a good job, who gave somebody a chance. Somebody who is generous, not only with his money, but with his time, his energy. He infused everybody with that attitude that we want to be the best. We want people to recognize our productions. We want people to know who we are. We want to set a standard that no one else can match in sports production work. And Mr. Sabol was the one who allowed us all. He gave us freedom, and Steve did the same thing. Dress the way you want. Eat the way you want. Do what you want in your own time, but when you're here, give it your all. And, you know, what an atmosphere. What a winning atmosphere he created, first at 230 North 13th Street, then at 330 Fellowship Road in Mount Laurel, and now here in our new complex, which we've been in, I say new, since 2001, mm-hmm. which is just a spectacular facility.
Yes,
I'm sure
is.
You've been here, you know what it's like. I mean, this is a production company. My goodness. who wouldn't want to walk in here every day and work?
All right. Bob Angelo, chief producer of NFL Films on the passing of Ed Sabol. Thanks so much for coming on.
Thank you very much for having me, Steve.
You got it.